Gulliver's Travels. Once upon a time, there was a man called Gulliver. He was a ship's doctor and often sailed to distant lands far away from home. But on one voyage, on board the merchant ship, the Antelope, he had no idea just how far the ship would carry him or what amazing adventures awaited him. After many months at sea, the ship sailed close to the shores of an unknown land. Suddenly, a terrible storm broke, and the wind blew the Antelope onto the rocks. Immediately, the ship split in two and sank. Wild with panic, the ship's crew threw themselves overboard, but only Gulliver managed to swim through the raging surf to the safety of the shore. All the other sailors were drowned. Pulling himself out of the water, Gulliver dragged himself up the beach. Then, completely exhausted, he fell into a deep sleep. How long he slept, he didn't know, for when he woke, the sun was shining fiercely into his eyes. With a groan, he tried to stretch himself, but to his horror, he found he couldn't move. His arms and legs and thick hair were tied firmly to the ground. Then he felt something crawling up his leg. Lifting his head as best he could, Gulliver saw a tiny man, no bigger than his little finger, walking on his chest. Then, to his astonishment, he saw at least 40 more of these little creatures clambering all over his body, and they were all armed with tiny bows and arrows. With a great roar, Gulliver tried to wrench himself free. He roared so loudly that many of the little men fell off his body and the others ran away. But when they saw that Gulliver could not break loose, they turned and let fly a shower of arrows, as small and sharp as pins. "Ow! Oof! Ouch!" cried Gulliver as the arrows hit him in the face. Then another volley hit him on the chest and hands. Wriggling and writhing in pain, Gulliver tried desperately to break the thousand threads that bound him to the ground. But it was no use struggling. The bonds were far too strong. Eventually, Gulliver gave up. He lay quietly on the ground and gradually fell asleep. After a while, the sound of hammering roused him. Turning his head as far as he could, he saw that a little wooden stage had been built by the side of his head and that a well-dressed man was slowly climbing onto it.
"Hello, Biggismo at Bubbles Lilliput. Ig Galbasto Magnifilus Imploribori,"
the man shouted into Gulliver's ear. I don't understand," said Gulliver. "Did you, say your country is called Lilliput?" Gulliver tried to make the little man understand that he was hungry and thirsty. But when they brought him a drink, it was drugged. While he slept, 500 carpenters and engineers built a low wooden cart to carry him away to see the Emperor of Lilliput. 900 men with poles were needed to lift him onto the cart, and more than 1,000 horses to pull it to the city. The procession stopped just outside the city, next to the ruins of an ancient temple. Here Gulliver was taken, and heavy chains were attached to his legs, fastened with hundreds of padlocks. Waking from his sleep, Gulliver found that the ropes around his body had all been cut. Slowly he got to his feet and looked around. To his amazement, he saw a whole city in miniature with houses, streets and parks lying at his feet. And all around were thousands of little people staring up at him, open-mouthed. Apart from the crowd stood a magnificent little horse. Mounted grandly on its back sat the Emperor. Taller and more handsome than any of the other people Gulliver had seen so far, the Emperor of Lilliput wore a helmet of gold, encrusted with jewels and decorated with a feathery plume. In his hand, he held a sword almost half his height, with a diamond-studded hilt. The horse reared up in terror when it saw Gulliver, so the Emperor dismounted and walked very grandly round Gulliver's enormous feet. Close to the temple stood a high tower. Almost as tall as Gulliver himself, it was by far the tallest building in Lilliput. The emperor and his courtiers climbed its stairs to have a better look at Gulliver. Then they spoke to him through loud hailers. But though Gulliver spoke to them in English, German, French, Spanish, and Italian, they seemed not to understand a word he said, and he could not understand them. The emperor came down from the tower and clapped his hands. Immediately, 20 carts piled high with meat and bread were brought to the giant. Looking down on the assembled crowd, Gulliver could pick out the ladies-in-waiting by their rich robes. As they curtsied to him, their satin cloaks and silver trains shimmered. They all looked so pretty that Gulliver wanted to pick one up and take a closer look at their doll-sized costumes, but he was far too polite. The ladies of the court, in their beautiful gowns, looked shocked and covered their eyes when they saw Gulliver picking up each cart in turn and gulping down the food. And when he swallowed whole barrels of wine, some of them actually fainted. At last, the royal visit ended, and Gulliver was left alone in the temple. Alone, except for the hundreds of tiny soldiers guarding him. But not everyone in Lilliput was happy with having a giant chained up so close to the city. That evening, a party of 6 men crept past the guards and attacked Gulliver with their arrows, spears, and knives. Quickly, the emperor's bodyguards rounded them up and tied their hands behind their backs. With the handle of his sharp pike, the captain of the guard drove the attackers closer and closer to Gulliver's outstretched hands. "They tried to kill you, giant," he seemed to be saying. "You deal with them." Gulliver swept his attackers up in his hand and pushed 5 of them into his pocket. The 6th he lifted up and held before his open mouth as if about to swallow him. How the little man shrieked and yelled! But Gulliver was really very gentle. He set his attacker down on the ground and then stood the other 5 beside him. As quick as a flash, they ran off as fast as their little legs would carry them. All Lilliput was amazed by Gulliver's gentleness towards the men who had tried to kill him. They ran with the news to the emperor's court. All the ministers of state were there, gathered to discuss what should be done with the strange giant washed up on the shores of Lilliput.
"Eg licky bugal begizimo evidali,"
said the emperor, which means, "He's obviously a friendly giant, there's nothing to fear." But chained up in the temple, Gulliver felt very lonely and wished he could escape and return home to his wife and children.